As I said, we have been in, and we are coming out of a series on the subject of money, generosity, giving, a lot of different ways that you could look at it. We entitled it Overflow. It was a great encouragement to me to hear the responses that you all had towards that and how it helps to remind us. And remember that during that series, what we would say is that the subject, really our first sermon series and that of the vineyard, our second one of overflow, and even into this one now that we will begin today, is about this idea of bearing fruit. And fruit in the last series was the fruit of generosity, the fruit of the abundance, the cheerful giving that we would sow bountifully and therefore reap bountifully the goodness of God. And that was really it. So fruit was a part of that. It certainly was a part of our first series. And as you'll find, it is also part of this one, but just with a little bit different nuance of fruit. We are beginning a sermon series we've entitled Incorruptible Gospel, and we will look at it in just a moment. Before we look at it together from God's Word, I want to invite a relatively new friend of mine up here on stage. Joe, if you would come on up. I'd love to invite to you, this is Joe Fiola. Maybe some of you know him. He and his wife have been attending for some time here at Faith Christian Fellowship. Joe, there you go. It's on. Good to see you, brother. Joe is a lover of the Lord Jesus Christ, right along with myself. But in addition to being a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, Joe is a professor. How about that, huh? A big idea. Joe is a professor of viticulture at the University of Maryland here locally. And so I've invited him. It was very interesting during our vineyard series. I knew that Joe was an expert in vines and in wine and in grapes and fruit of all sorts, that he was an expert. And so you can imagine me sitting up here teaching on the subject of a vine and a vineyard, looking out and finding Joe's face and wondering how many mistakes have I made on the subject of vineyard and vine growing. But I approached him one day after one of those services and I said, Joe, would you consider being a part of the conversation thanks to your expertise on this matter? And so we agreed that today might be a good day for us to do that. Joe and I got together this past Tuesday so that I would know how badly I taught the subject of vine growing before I shared it with you. I wanted to know ahead of time how bad it really was. But you can see a little bit of Joe's credentials up here and what he has done over the years. So maybe if we could, our team in the back, maybe put up that first picture. There it is. And I want you to know something as a disclaimer first and foremost. The subject is going to come up of wine in this conversation. I am neither endorsing nor condemning the enjoyment of wine today. I just want you to hear that. Everyone okay with that? But I do want you to hear from an expert, from the expertise of someone who does this for a living and knows more about this than has forgotten more than I'll ever know. And so tell us a little bit about where this starts, Joe. Tell us where this...
Yeah, thank you, Pastor Gordon. I like to start all my presentations on viticulture with this slide because it best depicts the axiom that to make great wine, you need to start with great grapes, that the wine is made in the vineyard. And the goal of every winery and vine grower is to make great wine, but you can't make great wine unless you start with great grapes. So everything you do from the vineyard, from pruning to training to thinning to making the final harvest is all done to get the best possible quality grapes, and therefore makes it easier to make the best possible wine from that.
Great. The wine is made in the vineyard. We'll come back to that in a little bit, but I just want you to store that away for a second. Let's go to the next picture if we could. Tell us a little bit about what this is.
Okay, basically to get the best possible grapes, the vine is a weed. The vine will go crazy, will grow crazy out of control. It is up to the vine tender to maintain it to get the best possible quality grapes out of it. And that involves a bunch of things, if you excuse the pointer here. Basically, this is a whole row of grapes. You see each vine here. You build this wall of basically solar collector where it collects the sun, produces all the sugar, and then you have this nice uniform line of grapes here. Here's a close-up of that. You see the leaves here. You pull the leaves away, and you have these nice uniform clusters. These are the best possible clusters on the vine, produce the best possible wine because they are the largest and the most uniform and all ripen at the same time. You could get grapes all the way up in here, but these are the best and most uniform, and these are the ones that we train to.
Isn't this fantastic? Okay, good. The next picture, if we could. What is this a picture of?
This is what vines look like right now before they're trained and pruned. So needless to say, they are out of control. Vine produces well over 100 times more wood than it really needs to produce the next crop. And it's the vine tender's job to cut away all that to the most important part to get the best quality fruit.
All right, let's take a look. What does that look like?
Okay, again, you saw this one. This is what we're looking for. This is if we are not pruning properly, not only during the dormant season, but also during the growing season. The grapes will continue to grow, and even during the growing season, we're constantly cutting away to prune back to keep it nice and manicured, just these leaves and the fruit here. You see here, there may not be any fruit in there, or there may be not a lot of fruit. It's not exposed and will not be good quality unless you constantly keep the vine in check.
So there is fruit up in this top picture, but it's often not good or lost in the leaves.
Right. Lost in the leaves will ripen differently because of lack of sun. There'll be diseases and rots in there.
Very good. Let's see another picture here. Show us what this is saying.
This is a picture representation of what the vine looks like before and after pruning. And basically, again, we're starting with the vine here, and this is the critical part. That is the vine that supports the rest of the growth in the fruit. This is all the excess growth that we've been pointing to. This is before pruning. All this is cut away, and all is left of all these canes that are growing here is these little stumps here called spurs, and there's two buds left on those. So all of this would produce fruit if we left it, but all the quality of the fruit would be very poor. These two buds down here on these spurs produce the best quality fruit. And of course, that all the energy comes from the vine here.
It was that, as I was talking to Joe, it was very interesting to me when he pointed out one morning when we were talking after the service, he pointed out that idea that the best, the sweetest, the best fruit is happening close, right directly to the vine. Doesn't that sound very, biblical and very, very true spiritually, that the very best fruit is that which is closest to the vine? Let's see another picture, a couple more here.
And this gives you a direct comparison of what would happen if you start a vine that is not pruned and let it grow. So you get all kinds of scattered growth, and therefore you get all kinds of scattered clusters. Here, if you prune a little bit with a machine, you get scattered growth, not as uniform. Here, machine and hand pruning. And finally, what we're looking for, nice uniform spaced shoots that will produce nice uniformly spaced clusters. And if you look over here, this is what the fruit you would get if you left it going without pruning. You get different spotty fruit, different size clusters. They ripen at different times, have different levels of diseases, as opposed to this proper one up here, where the fruit is nice and uniform, the largest clusters, the best quality clusters, because all the information that all the best quality is in this little area around the head of the vine.
And I think we have one more that kind of captures that same thought, yes?
And again, this is what we're ultimately looking for. Balanced, uniform, mature grapes produce the best quality fruit for producing the best quality wine.
Isn't that great? Can you guys give Joe a big round of applause for us? Thank you, brother. Thank you. I really appreciate it. As I said, we did an entire sermon series, and it's not so much that the application of us spiritually and biblically was incorrect, but I love bringing an expert up who deals with this on a daily basis and could help us see the truth of God's Word woven into something as simple as the true act of grape growing, fruit bearing. And so Joe was so very gracious to join me in that little project of sharing some of his expertise with us on what that even looks like. I'm going to come back to something in a few moments as we finish up the message today of something that Joe said, but we'll save that for the moment. Right now, what I'd love for you to do is to join me in God's Word. If you have your copy of God's Word, I would love for you to turn to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. The study of Incorruptible Gospel, this sermon series is going to go on for a little while. The study of it will be primarily, beginning next week, will be all the way through the great, great New Testament book of Galatians. It's one of my very favorites, and we'll talk more about that as we go through it, the book of Galatians. Today is meant to be sort of a launching pad into that, but not in yet Galatians yet. That will begin next week. And so today, I'd love for us to set the tone of that out of the book of Matthew chapter 7. So if you've got your copy and turn to that, I'd invite you to stand in honor of God's Word. and often my custom for us to read together the passage of Scripture, standing in honor of it. I'll be reading out of the New American Standard Bible, chapter 7 of Matthew, verses 15 to 23. 15 to 23, reading along quietly to yourselves as I read aloud. Jesus is talking. Matthew has recorded this. These are Jesus' own words. "Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? So every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then you will know them by their fruits. Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" May God add his blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of his word. You may be seated. The title of the series is Incorruptible Gospel. The title of today's message is Fruit and False Prophets. Fruit and False Prophets. Let me give you a little background to what we are reading. Jesus is the speaker, as I mentioned a moment ago. These are his words, and they are coming from a section of Scripture that we know of as the most famous sermon ever given by the most capable deliverer, Jesus Christ. The most famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. And it consists of the three chapters of Matthew, 5, 6, and 7. Last summer, if you've been with us that long, you would know that we went through the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, last summer. Don't worry if you were not here for that. You can catch up quickly. But today, instead of the beginning, we're looking at the end of the sermon, these words that we've just read. At the beginning of the sermon, or early on, Jesus gives the most important verse of the sermon pretty early in chapter 5, verse 20. He says there, "Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." When we talked about it last summer, the shock cannot be overstated. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, they would have thought, listening to Jesus' words, there is no such righteousness. There is no such person whose righteousness is greater than the scribes or the Pharisees. The Pharisees would exhibit in their eyes, in certainly the Pharisees' eyes and the people, the highest form of earthly righteousness. And so for Jesus to say, in order for you not only to be equal, but you must exceed that to enter the kingdom of heaven. And so a natural statement would come out of that of the following: then Jesus, who can be saved? It is impossible. It is impossible that someone could be saved if what you are saying is that righteousness must mean more than the Pharisees exhibit. They exhibit the most righteous. And so if you're telling me that's not enough, then there is no hope. And in a manner of speaking, that is true. That is true. And so now we jump to Matthew chapter 7. And the first thing I want you to observe in these verses is that there is a wicked deception afoot. A wicked deception afoot. Jesus says, remember, these are his words, near the end of his most famous of all sermons that he ever gives, and he says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." We don't exactly know who these false prophets are. in Jesus' description. The first thing we might imagine is that they are the Pharisees, but it's unlikely that they are the Pharisees. The Pharisees in Jesus' other places where Jesus describes this relationship, one in particular is in the book of John, chapter 10. When Jesus describes himself as the good shepherd of the sheep, and he describes himself in contrast to hired hands. Hired hands. You see, the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired workers would do what? They would run away and leave the sheep exposed to falsehood. Or in that case, in the image, to wolves, he describes in John 10. They are hired hands. They have no investment in the sheep. Only the good shepherd would lay his life down for the sheep, and only the good shepherd's voice do the sheep know. They don't know the hired worker's voice, and those hired workers run away when danger comes. Most likely, that would be the Pharisees, the hired workers. They don't have an investment in the well-being of the sheep. So who is Jesus talking about with the false prophets in this case? We don't necessarily know who that is, but we know what they are doing. First, we understand this, that they are dressing up as though predators, they are dressing up as prey. They are becoming sheep or clothed as such so that as wolves they might get close to the sheep and devour them. That's what the false prophets are trying to do. There is a wicked deception underway. And Jesus is saying to his listeners, beware of them. Beware. Well, the second thing I'd like to point out, and doing so, I jump a few verses to verse 21. The second thing is that there is an inarguable reversal. If the false prophets are those who are coming in sheep's clothing, but rather are inwardly ravenous wolves, this is a continuation of their story, and listen to what Jesus says. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. This is very interesting. I want to share with you, I did at the beginning of the year in our very first message on in the series of Vineyard, I talked about this, that John 15 has a tendency to strike fear in a lot of us because we read images of being cut away and burned up, and if we are not fruit producers, are we really even believers at all? And we get very afraid that, oh, Lord, I don't want to be the one who doesn't produce fruit. I want to be a fruit producer. Am I going to be cut away? Am I producing enough fruit that I might not be cut away and burned? And it makes me fearful. Well, if there is possibly one more fear-inducing passage than John 15, it would be Matthew 7, 21 to 23, wouldn't it? Will Jesus say to me someday, Gordon, I never really knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. I am afraid, or I have been at times in my life, afraid that I am at risk. Do I walk through each day at risk of being called out by Jesus? Gordon, I don't even know you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. You do not have entrance into the kingdom of heaven. Well, keep in mind that who he's talking about is false prophets. That's who he is continuing the story. Beware of these false prophets. And then he gets to verse 21 and is a continuation of that, basically saying it is the false prophets who that is going to be spoken of. But that in some ways that might not soothe you because you may wonder, am I a false prophet? Am I a false prophet? What does a prophet do? A prophet speaks truth, supposedly, right? That's what a prophet is supposed to do. Is it possible that I would be counted among them speaking and in such a way that Jesus would come to me at the end of my life and say, still, Gordon, I never knew you? Look at what causes them. Look at the strangeness of Jesus' rebuke and rejection of them. In verse 22, it says, some will come and say, Lord, Lord, did we not, what? Prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, perform miracles in your name. Shouldn't that be one who is welcomed into the kingdom? Wouldn't we think that such demonstration would welcome any person into the kingdom? In your name, we did these things. We did these miraculous things, these supernatural things. Presumably, they had some success with it, and yet the judge, the Lord Jesus Christ, at the end will say, I never knew you. That might be more unsettling or less, I don't know, for you. But as I read that, it is rather astounding that he is saying this, isn't it? That these are the works that you would expect from someone who is ultimately a resident of the kingdom of heaven. One who does these things in the name of the Lord Jesus. And yet he still says, I never knew you. So what are we to do with this? Well, the third and final point is, he invites us to be fruit inspectors. He invites us to be fruit inspectors. I want us to spend a couple of moments on this because it is so very important. Inside and outside of the church, we know the following phrase very well, don't we? Verse 16, the beginning of it says, you will know them by their fruits. Inside and out and outside the church, this is tossed around, what I would say, unfortunately, without understanding. You will know them by their fruits. You will know them by their fruits. Judge, judge, you will know them by their fruits. We use this as a statement to say, and we think that we are saying this as a relative observer of the outward works of someone else. You will know them by their fruits. We use it a lot to hold one another accountable to righteous or unrighteous outer works. I see what I would deem to be unrighteous works, or I would see what I deem to be righteous works, and I would make a judgment of that individual based upon that observation. Keep in mind verses 21 to 23. What would you have said of those who performed miracles, who cast out demons, and who prophesied in the name of the Lord? Would you have been one unlike Jesus? Would you have been one that said, wow, that resume looks good. Enter into the kingdom of heaven. I've got this one, Jesus. I can be your gatekeeper on this one. They look good. Come on in. And Jesus says, I never knew them. So the question is, what is the fruit? What is the fruit on which we can make this determination? He says, you will know them by their fruits. Let's read on. Jesus makes an interesting little turn. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? Notice his attention now shifts from the fruit to what? The tree, doesn't he? This isn't so different than John chapter 15. Remember John chapter 15, the heart of the message was the vine, the vine, the vine. The vine is the one that produces the fruit, not the branch. The branch merely bears the fruit. This is not any different. Can we judge, can we trust the condition of the vine in John 15? Absolutely, it's the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's the one producing fruit. The thing that Jesus is saying here in Matthew is, look at the tree. Look at the tree. Do you know what fruit is produced by that tree? Do grapes come from thorn bushes? That's silly. Do figs come from thistles? That's silly. Look at the tree. Look at what it should produce. And you'll have your answer. You know them by their fruits. But then he says, grapes? Figs? You know what they come from. You know what kind of tree they come from, what kind of plant. Look on at what he says. So every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Look at the tree. Look at the tree, and you will know what the fruit is supposed to taste like, what it is supposed to be, the sweetness and the fullness of that fruit. You know because you know what kind of tree it is coming from. A good tree produces good fruit. A bad tree produces bad fruit. The distinction here is not that outward works are what justify us. They never justify us, and in fact, they can sometimes mislead us, Jesus is saying. There is something deeper that we are judging the fruit of. What is that fruit? Jesus has another statement in a corresponding passage also in Matthew, this time in Matthew 12. Let's look at what he says in Matthew 12, verse 33. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. Well, that sounds similar, doesn't it? For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak what is good? For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The good man brings out of the good treasure what is good, and the evil man brings out of the evil treasure what is evil. But I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give an accounting for it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. What is a prophet supposed to do? A prophet speaks. A prophet declares something. The fruit that is talked about in Matthew 7 is the fruit of true doctrine. And I want you to hear that. See, we get afraid of doctrine. We get afraid of what, that word sounds very legalistic. It sounds very fundamental, doctrine. Gord, haven't we moved past doctrine? Haven't we moved past this idea of fundamentalism? We depend on it. We rely on true doctrine. We rely on truth in order to produce those good works that we think we are supposed to produce. Good works come from right belief. They come from right belief. A false prophet, like he says in Matthew 12, he also is saying in Matthew 7, it is important that your truth is established and is in fact truth, because the result of it will be good or bad fruit, depending on its validity. If it's good truth, if it's real, if it is truth, then it will produce good works. If it's false, then you can expect bad fruit. That is the tree that he is talking about. He is saying that they were teaching something that was not true. Not that they were doing something bad, but they were saying something that was untrue. Beware of false prophets. They are telling you something that is not true. Beware of them. They come as sheep, but are actually wolves. And they are looking to devour. Outside of the Bible itself, one of the most influential books in my personal life is a book by the name of The Reign of the Servant Kings. The author is named Joseph Dillo, and he writes in part in this book a short commentary on Matthew 7, what we've looked at today, and he says this: the fruit by which we may discern these false prophets is their doctrine. Their works were good. They looked and acted like sheep and even performed miracles. An examination of works would have led to the wrong conclusion. You see, in the church, we run the risk every day of determining someone's spirituality based on works. Jesus doesn't do that. He bases it on truth. Are you giving the true message that is of me? Or are you just simply doing works in my name, like he says at the end of this section that we've read? And in fact, I don't really know you. How is it that we can know Jesus truly and thereby be counted among those who are kingdom citizens? And that's where we find ourselves for this series, the incorruptible gospel. You see, the gospel is this, and I love how Richard did such a beautiful job of leading us in communion. The gospel says this: I am a sinner. I have no hope of finding a dwelling with a holy God in my current state, and I am desperate to figure out how to solve it. The problem is, I have come to the realization that I can't solve it. Remember in chapter 5, verse 20, what I said is the key verse of the Sermon on the Mount? Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And so the question is begged out of that, then who can be saved? And Jesus says elsewhere, with man, it is impossible. With God, though, all things are possible. We are saved by grace, period. No work that any of us can do. We are trying to corrupt it, usually on a daily basis. God, have I earned your acceptance today? God, have I done enough to receive your approval? And God says, what are you talking about, Gordon? That has never been the standard, and it isn't today, and it won't be tomorrow, and the day after that. Your acceptance is based on something entirely different than works. Your acceptance is based on the grace that I poured out through my Son, Jesus Christ. If you try and add anything to that, then you are stealing the very simple message of the gospel from it. You are corrupting it, and you have allowed yourself to be tainted and persuaded by false prophets. The reason Jesus said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven, because man's righteousness cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. There is only one's righteousness that invites any of us into the kingdom of heaven, and that is the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and we receive it by faith, and faith alone. The book of Galatians is probably the oldest or one of the oldest books of the New Testament. You might think it's Matthew or Mark or Luke or John because they come first, right? On the chronology of the writing of the New Testament, Galatians is one of the first one or two or three books written. And it was written by the Apostle Paul, and we will look at it in great detail over the next several weeks. But the reason I say this, it's foundational because the church was at a desperate crossroads at the time that he wrote it. The churches in Galatia, to whom he is writing, are trying to add to the gospel a works-based salvation. If you do these things, if you keep this law, if you hold on to it, and Paul, at the very beginning of the church, probably around AD 50, can you imagine? Jesus dies around AD 30 and is resurrected. Maybe 20 years later, we have the book of Galatians. And he is saying, beware. People are going to deliver to you a different gospel. Look at what he says in chapter 1 of Galatians. I'm amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we, or an angel from heaven, should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you received, he is to be accursed. Why does he say a gospel which is really no, if he teaches another gospel which is really no other gospel? What does that mean? That sounds confusing. What does the word gospel mean? Good news. Replace good news for gospel in that passage. If someone comes to you and preaches another good news, which is really to say it's not good news. Why? Because there's only one good news that Jesus has rescued. Jesus saves. That's the good news. Jesus saves. Add nothing to that. You can't. You are accepted based on no other standard than Jesus saves. And for the entire book of Galatians, in large part, he is going to strip away all of the things that believers at that time were tempted to add to that great news. Yes, it's good news that Jesus saves, but I still must do this, right? Yes, that's great news, but I'm still responsible for this, right? No. Do you want to produce fruit, good fruit? Of course you do. What's the basis of producing good fruit? Believe the right thing. You produce good fruit when you believe the right thing. What do you believe? That I can't produce good fruit. How ironic. I can't produce fruit, good fruit, apart from Christ. In order to produce good fruit, I must tell myself I can't produce good fruit. And Jesus says, that's all I needed to hear. Allow me to produce it through you. Jesus saves. That's it. When we encourage, or I should say maybe better, counsel fellow believers in the Lord Jesus Christ that are here at our church or our family, and we say to them, what is our guard against failed works, bad fruit? What is our guard? Try harder. Do it a little better tomorrow. Maybe you'll get it right in a week or so. Our counsel should always be, brother, Jesus saves. When you have failed, Jesus saves. When you have tried and failed for the 100th time, Jesus saves. And he will never leave you. And he will help you produce that good fruit, not of you, but of him. What is the great, great verse of Galatians? For I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live by faith in the one who loved me and gave himself up for me. Jesus saves. I close with the statement that Joe shared with us in his little presentation of fruit. Wine is made in the vineyard. Good wine is made in the vineyard. What does that mean? You don't take a bad tree and produce good fruit from it. You produce good fruit from a good tree. It starts in the vineyard. It's the vine. And God is ready to produce in us good fruit if we will get out of the way and serve as nothing other than branches to hold it. When you are counseling and meeting and encouraging a brother or sister in Christ, encourage them with an uncorrupted gospel. My brother, Jesus saves. I know you have failed. I know you feel your failure. You know the best news I can offer you is Jesus saves. Over the next several weeks, we're going to explore how Paul had to handle a temptation of corrupting that message over and over and over again, adding something that was not there. And I want you to hear, hopefully in truth, as a would-be prophet, Jesus saves. Cling to nothing else than that. Let's pray. Father God, we pray that over these next several weeks, that our gospel understanding would grow beyond our wildest imaginations. That we would come to know that the gospel in and of itself, by itself, is what we build our life on. If we bring to you anything that is of merit, we realize that it is ushered away and you strip it away and you prune it. Prune it away because it produces bad fruit. Only that which is clinging closely to the vine, tightly to the vine, life-giving vine, and says, I can do nothing. The only fruit that I can produce is from Jesus living in me. The incorruptible gospel, Lord, may you grow us in it over these next several weeks, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.